7th episode of Officially Unofficial, the other side of a successful leader. I'm Sunandan, Bhanja Chaudhury, and with me, the man, my host, my favorite guy, the evergreen and ever smiling host this afternoon, Anu. Or as you guys would know him, of course, as Dr. Annurag, Batra, Chairman and Editor-in-Chief of Businessworld and Exchange for Media. Anu, with all these webinars you're doing nowadays, you should be knighted, man.
I think it'll happen soon.
You are obviously giving a lot of nokri to lots of people in this country.
Sunandan, isn't that what we should be doing? That's the right thing to do. That's what India needs.
Absolutely.
For that, the board members will need to play a very
realize that today we have someone with us who took the world by storm and created history just by helping get Nokri. So let me do a quick introduction, although he does not need one here or anywhere around the world, right, Anu?
We can say, Sunandan, that he's never made a CV in recent time. It's other people's CVs that he looks at.
His
CV has been looked for other things, which we'll come to, of course, in the episode. But go on.
Yes, but let me open the Wikipedia page on Sanj. Sanjeev attended the St. Columbus School, Delhi, and thereafter he obtained the Bachelor of Arts degree in Economics from St. Stephen's College, Delhi, in 1984. He completed his MBA from IIM Ahmedabad in 1989. Founder and Executive Chairman of InfoAge, which owns Nokri.com, and co-founder of Ashoka University. And he was given the Padma Shri Award, one of the highest civilian awards in India, in Jan 2020. Sanj, we have a surprise for you to begin with. Here is a fan of yours who sent a song for this episode 11,000 kilometers away.
The waves sparkle at evening's play against your skin so brown. I want to sleep with you in the depth of the night, with a billion stars all around. And I got a peaceful, easy feeling. I know you won't let me down, but I'm already standing on the ground. And I found out a long time ago what a woman can do to your soul. But she ain't got you anyway, and you don't know what to hold. I got a peaceful, I know you won't let me down, 'cause I'm already standing on the ground.
So this is for you, my friend. Bichu was one of my dearest, closest friends. Somebody who inspires me, has always inspired me, continues to inspire me, and I want to be like you, Bichu. Love you, my brother. Take care.
Yeah, so Niren used to sing a song in college, and he won a lot of contests doing it in Delhi University.
You know, and he came on our show about 2 weeks, 2 months back, actually, and he sang as well. So he remembers you very fondly. I mean, he and you were in class 5 together. And what were you like in school, Sanj? I mean, naughty or a nerd? Niren as well.
No, I wasn't very studious. I didn't ever come first in class or anything. But in the exams that counted, I did well enough to, achieve what I wanted to achieve. But for the rest of the time, I was not very studious. So yeah, I mean, it was somewhere in the middle, you know, neither a nerd, neither a very naughty guy. I wasn't the guy in class who got in the most trouble, but I wasn't the guy in class who I came the top 1, 2, or 3 either.
Ah, interesting.
Anu? Yeah, Sanjeev, a lot of people in their life aspire to be CEOs, you know, chairmen, but it takes another kind of aspiration, skill, luck to be a Padma Shri. So, what got you there?
Any tips?
Yeah, so look, I mean, I don't know. I didn't, apply for it. I didn't ask for it. I didn't ask anybody to nominate me. You know, I was very pleasantly surprised to see my name in the list.
Yeah.
In January when it happened, so I didn't know it was coming.
Absolutely. I mean, this is something that, you know, is fantastic, really. You know, I mean, nothing you can prepare for.
I know. And you know, so we should be, Sunandan, we should be calling him Padma Shri Sanjeev Bikhchandani.
Actually, yes. I don't know if that's allowed. I mean, okay, I'm not allowed to use it in that fashion. Okay. There's some norms, nomenclature. I have not studied them.
Okay.
There's some protocols.
But how did it change? What once you got the Padma Shri, what was the change?
So actually, technically, I've not got it yet. The ceremony didn't happen because of COVID.
Yes.
My name's on the list. Yeah, but I've technically not got it yet.
You know, Sanjeev, you're also the chairman of the Entrepreneurship Council of the Delhi government, right?
So that was about 4, 5, 6 years ago, and we did some work, but you know, that is, I think, not doing much right now.
Okay.
Sanjeev, I want to go back many, many years. I mean, not at the school time, but later on, you know, when you joined HMM, and of course, it was later called Smith Kline Beecham. And you joined and you left very quickly in 1.5 years. And, you know, I remember we had gone out for lunch as a farewell, Rajiv Chandra, you and I, to Connaught Place. And that was about, 20 odd years back. And I remember seeing...
About 30 years ago. Yeah.
30 years back, okay. You did what everybody wants to do, but no one had the courage to do. Remember that?
I remember you telling me that. In fact, you know, when I quit my job, you were the only guy who told me that.
Yeah,
everybody else was kind of very surprised. I was leaving a good job in a large MNC, handling a good brand, and going out and trying to do something, you know, on my own with no big idea in mind. Just sort of, you know, drifting and trying, exploring and trying to do something. But basically, I decided, look, I don't want that life. I didn't want to work as a professional manager in a large company and work my way up the ranks, where your future is kind of predicted and predictable. Where you know if you're all right, in 3 years' time, you'll be in that cabin, 6 years' time in that cabin, and 15 years' time, maybe head of marketing somewhere, either here or somewhere else. And essentially, your benchmarks and parameters for success were where you lived, how large your house was, how big your car was, whether you could afford an overseas holiday or not. You know, I didn't want to struggle for that kind of thing. And I said, you know, at the end of the day, you know, after 20, 30, 40 years, when you retire, you look back, what would you have achieved? And I said that, look, if I stay on in the corporate sector, you know, it'll be a comfortable life financially. But impact, I did not know. I was uncertain. So I said, listen, I don't know what I'm going to do, but I certainly don't want this. So I quit.
Yep. Took us all by surprise. But that I can never forget. Anu? But tell me, Sanj, your dad was a doctor, your mom a homemaker. Where does this entrepreneur gene come from?
I don't know if it's a gene or not, but it's something that I wanted to do. I wanted to be independent. I wanted to be on my own. So I think independence has been a big thing for me right from the beginning, since I was very young.
Okay, yeah.
And I found that, corporate hierarchies were stifling, at least in the late 80s, early 90s, pre-liberalization. Managers are not empowered really at the junior level. And so I found that, you know, it's not really rewarding or fulfilling.
You know, I remember those days when I was in JWT and we had this joke, you know, about your company, by the way, HMM, and you know that HMM was half MM. you know, and we call that because of the changes that used to happen on the artwork, and the copy was mostly half mm. But and I remember with so many committees looking at half mm, you surely did not enjoy being so precise.
No, I mean, you enjoy working with people, and there were good people there. So I enjoyed my time at HMM, but it's not what I wanted to do long term.
Yep.
So I recall, there was a Horlicks bottle. Horlicks had a label,
I was coming to that.
Yeah, and the label was a blue label with a red border, thin red border.
Yeah.
Now, sometime before I joined, maybe 6 months before I joined the company, so HMM would run by committee. On the first, there would be a purchase committee meeting. On the second, a menu. On the third, a sales committee meeting. On the fourth, a marketing committee meeting. On the fifth, finance committee meeting. And on the sixth, the management committee meeting. Right? And all big decisions were taken in these committees.
Right.
And the brand I was working on, Horlicks, was 88% of company turnover, 103% of company profit.
That's profits.
Didn't take any decision. The CMD was effectively the brand manager because it was too important to the company.
Simon Scarf.
Mm. Right. So sometime 6 months before I joined, somebody made a suggestion that, listen, in India, gold is considered valuable.
Hmm.
So if you put a half mm line of gold between the red border and the blue main body of the label, it'll create a value perception.
Wow.
And then somebody else said, I think you're right, but it's too much of a risk.
Okay.
Now, so why don't we test market this new label in Madurai?
Hmm.
Why Madurai? Because Tamil Nadu is the most important market, but Kanpur is the biggest city, which is Madras. So let's do it Madurai.
White border market, right?
Hmm. And so this new label was introduced to Madras, in Madurai. And then people forgot about it. Now, a typical test market is 3 months, 6 months. A year went by and I joined the company. I didn't know about this test market. And one day the CMD remembered, hey, what happened to that test market? He asked in one marketing committee meeting. So everybody was in a flap because they'd forgotten about it. So I was promptly dispatched to Madras that evening. And I caught the overnight bus to Madurai. It was a, it's a difficult journey, an overnight bus to Madurai. It's hot and dusty. And I changed my clothes at 4:30 a.m. in the back of the bus, I had a lot of work in Delhi, and I told my boss, I said, why do you have to go to Madurai for this? You can check out the sales data, right? If the sales data has neither moved up nor down, it stayed the same, it doesn't do any harm. If it's moved up, great. It could be for five other reasons you don't know, right? Only if it's moved down. In any case, let me tell you, this won't make a difference. And common sense tells me that using a thin gold line will not make a difference. And that was blasphemy, Horlicks label was sacred. I went to Madurai.
Uh-huh.
I spent the morning just going from shop to shop with the local sales guy. And Dwarka is here.
Yes.
Local sales guy. And I, kept asking the question, and they kept laughing in my face and saying, we don't know what you're talking about. Right? Because they themselves don't notice it. Right?
You had them translating, no? Generally.
Yeah, I had the local sales guy translating. I couldn't speak Tamil, and they won't. They couldn't understand English, and Hindi was not a good idea.
Not a good idea.
Okay, so anyway, I came back to Delhi, and I said, please extend label nationally. But that said, what am I doing here? We are the gods of small things. It's really not what I want to do the rest of my life. Spent a lot of time doing very, very small stuff. Which is, perhaps a wrong attitude, but it's not what I wanted to do.
Yeah. But what about the story? Did the needle move?
Oh, no. It made no difference.
Okay.
In many of these things that we do in large corporations, they make no difference. So you end up for many years being a minion who's working on a process. And you're not sure, what that process adds up to, what the outcome adds up to.
Yep.
So I wasn't very happy. Although I was having fun with the colleagues, but that was more a social thing as opposed to a, what am I making of my life thing.
Well, interesting, hilarious. But so you left to create your own office in your dad's servant quarters.
Yeah, we had to find some place to sit. So
yep.
The servant quarters vacant. So I paid 800 rupees a month rent, I remember. My dad didn't want it, but I insisted.
Any lessons from dad that's lived with you for so many years?
I think all of us, yeah, who grew up in middle class families, you know, what we learn from our parents, from our families, I mean, a lot of that stays with us. Whether it is, you know, being frugal, whether it is being honest, working hard,
right.
You know, staying with it, don't give up, humility, be good to the other guy, you know, all of those things. I mean, they stay with you, yeah. So those become your values as you go along. And I think all of us are that way roughly similar. We had a similar background upbringing, roughly similar.
Yeah, absolutely. But tell me, let me go back to your first job, and you know, after Stephens, you joined Linters. And I believe you did have a lot of interaction with Alec. Alec Padamsi was a very interesting character. I have many anecdotes.
You couldn't be in Linters and not have a lot of interaction with Alec. I think, everybody had a lot of interaction with Alec.
Yep.
So, yeah, Alec was quite a character. Not a very easy guy to work with. And his word was law. And so, if you could avoid working with Alec, you prefer to do that. Right? But many times, and Dinesh is here, I don't know what he recalls, but you know, of Alec Padamsi. But I mean, nice guy, well-meaning guy, but hard to work with.
No, he was very interesting. You know, I mean, I remember him introducing him to Anup Chib in one of the parties, and I said, HMM, and he went singing HMM, you know, HMM and all that, you know, I mean, that was Alec, you know, I mean, he can make a song out of everything, you know. Anup, where are you?
I never worked with Alec, I worked with you. I'm so upset that you're not as mad as Alex, but maybe when in your second life you can be as mad as Alex. Sanjeev, now you've been a very successful entrepreneur, but your parents come from different professions. Your father was a doctor, your mother is a homemaker. So where did you pick up the genes of entrepreneurship?
I think you missed it.
There's no gene as such. I mean, along the way, you sort of figure it out. And, all first generation entrepreneurs are probably the first entrepreneurs in their families. So it's not a gene as such. It's something that you pick up along the way. I wanted independence. I wanted to do something different. I didn't want to work in a large organization. My former boss and colleague, Dinesh Khanna, who's on this call, I think also felt similarly about large organizations, and he quit to become a photographer. I quit to, you know, do databases and reports. And we're all doing our own thing.
Yeah.
And you know, you started...
And another colleague of ours, I mean, Ritu Sethi, she quit to work on tribal arts. Another colleague, Sanjeev Mehta, quit to make films.
Yep. Passion.
But Sanjeev, you started your father's, so to say, space in the home. And tell us what you learned from your father. We all learn a lot from our father, sometimes what to do and sometimes what not to do.
No, I think you were out at that time. You missed that bit. I think Sanjeev has already been through all that. We've just spoken about it. But you want to add to that, Sanj?
Yeah, I mean, look, so my father was, the refugee family from Pakistan, both on the mom's side and my dad's side. So, you know, having come from Sindh, I think he did the safest thing possible. He joined the government. And so he was very risk averse, you know, and he would always tell us to sort of study hard, be frugal, don't spend beyond your limits. If you study hard and do well, you know, doors will open. And so I think the value of hard work, the value of being frugal, the value of being honest, I think all those he told us about. And he didn't, I'm almost never explicitly telling us about it, but he lived that life. So that's if right. You observed him,
yep.
You know, those are some of the lessons you got. But I think many of our parents are the same of that generation. That generation who've been through partition.
Absolutely, life lessons. We just spoke about Alec.
And so,
not coming very clearly. Annurag. Anu, come again. I think back to you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead. I'm listening.
No, we just spoke up with.
Yes, I can.
About Alec and you know, his time with working with Alec. And I remember those days. Anything you want to ask? Okay, let me. People remember you actually, Sanj, as somebody who's always been there when they need you. You know what? How do you manage to keep so connected with your friends in school and college? Doesn't it make you shift your eyes from the ball?
Well, not really. You can manage. I mean, you know, it's a communicating is not hard, and I do turn up for sort of school events or college events or just meet friends, you know.
Right.
And you know, if you're a school friend, you're a school friend. Yeah, I mean, that's not going to change, no matter who's gone where in life.
Yep. That is true, and that's where Niren comes in. Niren Chaudhury now in Boston. With Panera, he remembers you very fondly. And the first thing he said when he saw the banner is that, you know, I'm going to sing for Sanj, for Bichu, as he calls you. So there you are. Talking about the ball, what ball game do you play or follow?
Oh, no, used to play. I don't play any sports anymore. But yeah, I mean, in school I was playing... whatever I could get my hands on, I mean, cricket, hockey, football, table tennis, swimming, athletics, you know, never good at anything. I mean, never outstanding anything, but always there in the class team, there was a school team.
Oh.
I was a trier, but not a big achiever on the sports field.
I played a lot.
Fair bit.
You know, I believe you love, I heard that you love period dramas, history and documentaries. And, you know, given a choice, whose documentary will you make, Sanj?
Oh, that's a tough one. I'm very, very interested in modern history, you know, okay. Especially modern Indian history, you know, whether it is the British era, whether it's the freedom struggle, whether it is post-independence. So probably something on Indian history is something that will interest me a lot.
That'd be nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anu?
Yes, and you know, Sanjeev, while you run a company, you give time to your friends, you give time to your alma mater. How do you find time? What does a typical day look like?
Well, actually, I don't give so much time. You know, those are a couple of phone calls here there, you know, and mostly on weekends. Right. So, for example, you know, today evening we have a call on Ashoka University. Right, but it's Saturday. Weekdays, I don't do that. I try and avoid doing that. So most of
your weekday look like?
I mean, the COVID is working from home morning to night on Zoom calls, and stuff like this on weekends, interspersed with work calls.
Yeah.
So I think it's morning to night now. It was also morning to night earlier as well. But, you know, I think as an entrepreneur, and you know it, Annurag, you're an entrepreneur, you know, you have to be available 24/7. You know, you have to be around 24/7. You have to be willing to work 24/7, even if you don't have to work.
So how do you unwind then, Sanjeev? Well, I know you said you're interested in modern history, but then how do you unwind?
I read a bit. I watch a few movies. I consume a lot of content online as well.
But what keeps you? I mean, does anything keep you awake at night ever? And what would that be?
Well, actually, I sleep quite peacefully at night. I'm all right on that one.
Okay. That, of course.
Yeah. So, you know, no, I'm no longer CEO of the company. So, I've delegated, you know, that's this has taken over. So, I don't have to deal a lot with the operational nitty-gritty of stuff. So, you know, for the last 10 years, life has been perhaps less stressful than it was earlier.
You know, someone said the other day that investors would put money on you as they feel they can trust you, very importantly, and that their money is safe and that you can think of solutions out of the box. You know, all that you learned from your business school seems to have no value.
No, it, I mean, there is value. There is value. But, you know, this is also important. And this can't be taught in a business school. No.
Absolutely.
Trust people still carrying, you know, a team with you. You can talk about it in a class, but you can't really teach it.
True.
Right? So, you learn a lot of stuff in business schools. Some of it is useful. But there's a lot of stuff beyond business school which also you need to learn.
Anu and I did a very interesting webinar, which was about what they don't teach you in the business school. And we had one of your, I think, teachers, you know, marketing teachers, Ibrahim Koshi, on the show as well. Very interesting. Yeah. There are so many things that, you know, that need to be added on, or maybe can be or may not be able to teach, for that matter. Anu?
Yeah, and you know, Sanjeev, you talked of consuming content. Now, I'm told you're a big foodie and you do a lot of research on food and you like going to street joints. And even if you visit a place like Amritsar, you've done enough research to be able to take your friends to this.
Well, actually, last month I've been on a diet trying to lose weight. COVID time anyway, you're not going out.
True.
But I'm fond of food.
So what are your top 5 places to eat in Delhi? Or the top 5 places that Sanjeev Bikhchandani likes to eat at?
More than top 5 places, I'd say it's kind of food. I'm, you know, there are 2-3 good Japanese restaurants in Delhi. You know, I mean, you go out, what, once or twice a month, right? Maybe thrice a month. So, you know, I like Japanese food, I like Chinese food, I like Indian food, I like,
Peruvian food.
Well, you don't get that much in Delhi.
That is right.
When you travel, yeah.
But are you like me as a bong who live to eat, or do you eat to live?
A bit of both.
Bit of both. Okay.
And Sanjeev, I before Sunandan gets into his quick rapid fire and, you know, some interesting binary choices, let me ask you, you know, the rules of entrepreneurship have changed post-COVID. Like, for example, less is more. For example, never say never, question every matrix. Profit has to be more than cost. What has changed about entrepreneurship and being an entrepreneur in the last 8 months?
So I think people have learned to prioritize and focus on that which is essential and important, and knock off the fluff.
Yeah.
It's quite simply because in many cases, you know, cash may or may not be available. Right. The way it was earlier. So yeah. Conserve cash while keeping the business going. Take some risks and see some new opportunities, right? And you know, bide your time till the market comes back. Okay, so this is about customers, customer service, revenue,
right? Yeah,
and product and service delivery.
Yeah,
the stuff that's absolutely essential.
So on okay. The unofficial side,
the food tech sector, the food delivery sector where we invested in Zomato.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Zomato is very close to profit. Swiggy is also prioritizing, unit economics. So people are doing whatever it takes to make things happen.
And Sanjeev, when you invest now, I mean, you both as an individual and, your fund, Naukri is, invest. You're a very prolific investor. You talked about Zomato. Now, when you invest post-corona, apart from the things you mentioned, what are the sectors that you're investing in? And
Invest largely in consumer internet, mobile app, tech kind of companies, B2B SaaS, because that's what we understand and know best. Right? Those are the sectors of our interest. But obviously, within that, you know, you pick companies and entrepreneurs. So we prefer to look at it bottom up. So, you know, if we invested in Zomato in 2010, first time, we didn't do it top down. We just liked the product. We liked the team. And we said, let's go for this. Right, bottom up. If you told me, do it top down, I would never have thought of a restaurant listing company. Likewise for Policy Bazaar. You know, if you told us top down, we would never have thought of insurance comparison. So there are plenty of good entrepreneurs out there trying to do stuff that you cannot think of or imagine. right? But if you think they're doing well, and you know, if you think it makes sense, you know, we back them. So it's bottom up, not top down.
And thank you, Sanjeev. Thank you so much, Sanjeev.
Should I?
Yes, Sulu.
Okay, given your love for food, Sanj, our next segment is going to be totally based on that. Yeah, it's called unofficial time. And now you're allowed to skip a minimum maximum of 3 questions with a no comment, but rest you're going to have to answer. So are you ready?
Absolutely.
So let's get on with it. Sushi or yellow dal?
Both. But not at the same time.
Yes, of course. Michelin star restaurant or mom's dal and chawal?
Again, both, you know. So look, on food, I'm very, very sort of experimental and open to trying stuff, new stuff. So yeah, so both.
Absolutely. Peruvian food or Brazilian food?
So I have never had Brazilian food, but I like Peruvian food. So I'll say Peruvian.
Yeah, I know. You keep talking about Peruvian. So I said, you know, let me check this out. Or what is the most overrated food in history?
Well, anything that's not been prepared properly. Anything. And the best food is something that's been prepared properly. So I think, look, all foods are good if prepared properly. I mean, you know, food carries a lot of, most food, you know, carries a lot of tradition, culture, history, along with it.
No, absolutely.
And it's got the, you know, the culinary wisdom of generations and centuries.
Yeah.
And you know, today we are discovering, rediscovering, undiscovering stuff that one day it's a bad idea to have eggs, the other day it's a good idea to have only egg whites, the third day it's a, even the yolks are good, it's okay. Or, you know, fat is bad, but now desi ghee is good.
Yeah.
Okay, you know, so all sorts of things.
True. So is it Sanjeev Kumar or Gordon Ramsay?
I'm not Kumar, but certainly, but no, I'm Sanjeev.
Sanjeev Kapoor, sorry, Kapoor.
Oh, Sanjeev Kapoor.
Yeah.
So, I think Sanjeev Kapoor. I see. Even when I traveled overseas, you know, after 4-5 days of eating international food, you know, you ultimately want to eat Indian food. After it takes maximum 1 week.
Ah, yep, that is true. Most overrated chef in history.
Most overrated chef in history? I would not know. I don't follow chef.
Food you will never get tired of.
Home food.
Most underrated food in the world.
Again, home food.
On a different note, have you ever felt like you were underperforming?
Always. I think the thing about people who are in demanding jobs is that they almost always believe that they need to do more. It's not enough.
It's never enough, actually. You can always do better. I remember,
which is why you keep trying and keep doing more.
Yep. I remember during those Lintas days, and I worked in Lintas for a short while, Alec had this thing which we had put on our softboard all across. What value have you added today? Do you remember that?
Yeah, well, no, that's after my time. My time, the slogan was raising standards, meeting commitments.
Yep. So, what trait are
every
you?
Every year there was a new slogan.
Sorry?
Every year there was a new slogan.
New slogan, yeah. What trait are you most proud of?
So, I think, what I believe is that just as a child, you know, learns the most in the first 3-4 years of his or her life,
mm-hmm.
right? I think as an adult, you learn the most in the first 3-4 years of your job.
Yep.
And the first 3-4 years will determine your work ethic, your professional standards, your integrity in the workplace, how you treat people, how hard you work, all of that. And therefore, I think it's really important for people to really work in the right place in the first 2-3 years of their career and work with very smart people. I think I was very fortunate that my first job was at Lintas. I worked there for 3 years and I worked with some really great people. So great environment, great clients, great colleagues, great bosses, you know, and a kind of pressure cooker environment where you had to, you know, give it your all. So I was a trainee in client servicing, you know, and if you're a, you know, client servicing trainee, you are at the bottom of the food chain, right? You are responsible and accountable for outputs and outcome, but you have zero authority.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and you've got to get work from, done from people who are not reporting to you, who are older than you, who are more experienced than you, who believe you're an idiot, right? So, you know, whether it's the copywriters, the art directors, the creative director, the art production manager, the finishing artist, the spray artist, the you know, the media operations guy, the media planning guy, the you know, the filmmaker, whoever, right? And you've got to coordinate all their efforts and make sure the output comes in time and is the right quality, right? And they don't have to do it for you.
Yeah.
But if somebody misses a deadline, right, he will not be accountable. You will be accountable.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And to get output of the right quality in the right time, then I think for a someone like me requires a lot of effort. And that is where I really sort of learned from people and imbibed people skills, imbibed a whole bunch of things.
Right.
Which really, I think, helped me. So if, you know, if today in our company, the work ethic is something, somewhere there's a little bit of what I will learn in the first 3 years of my career at LinkedIn.
Very interesting observation.
So it was a cradle, it was a nursery. It was where, you know, I learned so many things.
You know, this is very fundamental and very interesting observation. The first 2-3 years of your life in the corporate world actually determines a lot of things in the future. What is that trait that you wished you had?
The trait that I wished I had? I wish I could sing. I wish I could play a musical instrument. I wish I could act. I wish I could paint.
Yeah, great. Last question. Rapid fire. Who do you want to be remembered as? An innovator, a social change agent, always there for all, or a foodie?
Remembered as, I think, if I can be remembered as somebody who helped build institutions, you know, an institution builder.
Yeah.
Okay, that is something I think very, very worthwhile.
Absolutely. You know what? Today we have three people, some, you know, some people you know, you worked with, and some people you have associated with, fantastic people on the show. And, you know, I would like to welcome them. We have three special guests today. P. Dwarkanath, non-executive chairman of GSK earlier. And
hi, Dwarka.
Hi, Sanjeev.
PDN, right? PDN, you, I think. And then, of course, we've got Bala Deshpande, senior manager.
Dwarka recruited me into HMM. And HMM was where I got the insight where we should want to become Naukri, by the way. So, in a way, Dwarka has a hand in Naukri.
Yes. First mentioning, Dwarka, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, you see, I can never forget my interactions with Sanjeev. You know, it's very easy to say today because he's a very successful institution builder. But having said that, I mean, when we hired him, he was an outstanding man. I want to say about two things about Sanjeev without trying to embarrass him. Number one, he had 3 years experience. He had a very rich background being an IIM Ahmedabad guy. And he was only looking for an FMCG marketing, if I recall, only in Delhi because of his personal reasons. So one company is already ruled out. The only company is HMM at that time in Delhi. I think, you know, we hired him. What I realized was, having spent 3 years, he learns the tricks of the trade and he understands the business environment. But though he was appointed as a management trainee, he never shown, look, I have 3 years experience. And the humility he demonstrated at that time is extremely high. I heard Sanjeev would say, Sanjeev, according to me, has left GSK at the wrong time. Because the whole cultural changes have happened.
So I think all companies in India, the corporate sector, you know, post-liberalization, there was a huge culture change. Yeah. And if that happened earlier, I might never have left.
Then you would have been something else. I'm glad that you left before that happened. it's one is a corporate change, Sanjeev. Secondly, if you recall, the merger happened in 89. The integration work completed in 91 when we started doing the Simply Better culture. According to me, I spent 40 years. According to me, the whole milestones have changed since 92. And it's a different company for many years. But I'm glad that he left at the right time. Otherwise, I don't think he would have think of going it earlier.
I remember you telling me about your conversation with Anup Chip, you know, when...
You see, Anup has just become the head of marketing at the time when Sanjeev was decided to quit. Sanjeev had a chat with me. I felt, you know, somehow, you know, I've seen his passion, what Sanjeev had alluded earlier. His passion he has expressed, he was very determined, he was very confident. The only question, being a conservative guy coming from a service background and knowing him well and some of his colleagues, I said, look, well, you are leaving a very good plum job, MNC, FMCG, a blue chip company. He said, look, Dwarka, it's not that something wrong, but I have a very different thinking. I want to make a try. Let me try. Then Anup was not leaving him. He had talks, stay back sometime, partner, we'll do this and that. When he came back to me, get me my release. So then we had a chat with Anup. Look, if he's so determined, I see there is a streak of entrepreneurship with him. Let him go. I think we should allow him to go. That has happened. It's not that Sanjeev wouldn't have gone earlier, but we made the passage smoother and seamless. Everybody was stunned. How can a person leave after spending 2.5 years when he's have a great career? He has been rated as a very high.
We all were. Let me, by the way, introduce Bala Deshpande. Bala, are you online?
Yes,
director of the venture capital firm New Enterprises Associate. Bala, lovely to meet you. And I know there are many years that you guys know each other for many years, and I'm sure there are a few questions you would like to ask him which you may possibly never have asked him before.
No, I don't think I have any questions for Sanjeev, because I think he gets
you ask question. You ask, he'll answer the question for me.
Correct. Yeah, so Sanjeev, when I go back 20 years and, it's one of those very rare relationships which transcended from being purely professional to being personal friends. Especially if you're an investor, you can pretty much imagine that we are normally in many companies, you're on the other side of the table because, you're... you have a point of view, etc., etc. But I think that is the beauty about Sanjeev. He always maintained the two relationships in complete compartments. When we were talking personally, it was always personal, and we had a chemistry which I cherished, and I really enjoyed the various dinners with him, including telling this particular item is very good. And by the way, I am the complete opposite of him. I don't eat food, so it was still, our friendship survived that, I think. But as an investor, I think, the one thing that I've always wondered and admired about Sanjeev is his ability to ensure that everybody around him makes as much money or is as successful. I've asked him this in the past. I said, you are the most dilution insensitive entrepreneur that I have seen in my 20 years of investing. And, and he's always said that, I want everybody to win. I want my stakeholders, my employees, the kind of ESOP policy that he has done, or, the personal dilution he has taken to build the institution that he is, which was his aspiration. It's amazing. So, it takes a different kind of a person to say that, of 5 billion, I'm going to make less, but everybody else around me is going to make more money. Fantastic. I think that is a most, as an investor, that is something that I really treasured and, stayed with him 5 years before exiting.
Amazing. I can reveal it now. But Bala, you're the one who actually told me makes you trust him and money is saved, things out of the box, by the way. And I referred to that a little earlier. So that was you.
Yeah.
But Dwarka, be on the line. We want you there.
I'm on the line.
Yeah. I also want to bring in Dinesh Khanna, well-known photographer and advertising man and the first boss of Sanjeev at Lintas.
Hey, Dinesh.
Thanks for coming.
Listen, I can't call you Sanjeev, nor can I call you Bikhchandani, so I'm going to call you Bichu. It feels very strange.
Absolutely, yeah.
But lovely being here, and this is wonderful. And you know, the other thing I would like to say with a great deal of pride is that I probably know Bichu for longer than anyone else on this panel right now.
Yes.
I've known Bichu since 1982, was it?
84.
Definitely.
June 15th.
Yeah.
June 15th was my joining date in Lintas.
And
I've still got my first apartment there.
Yeah. And if I may just take off on a point which he made about, you know, how it's so important to get the right kind of job and work environment in the first 3-4 years of your career, I will disagree with him to the extent that he made sure that it was the best time those first 3-4 years. And I've seen enough trainees go through the, you know, 10 years which I spent in the corporate world, where not all of them made, you know, the kind of value which, or got that kind of value from those first 2-3 years as Bichu did. He would have made sure, irrespective of what company he was in, irrespective of what situation he was in, or what kind of responsibilities he was given, to extract value out of it. I mean, that is what makes Bichu so special. He was the most enthusiastic and therefore at times the most irritating trainee one could have, because he wanted to do everything.
Everything.
You know, like he said, you know, there were all these other people above him in the food, in the food chain within the agency, and he was at the end. Of course, that was true. And of course, they would always look down upon the trainee, but he wanted to make sure that he got all of them to work for him. And that's what he was very good at. And I'm sure that's not true as a trait for everyone. This is something which is very special for Bichu. And I'm sure that's something he's carried through with, you know, through, you know, various other aspects of his career and his entrepreneurship and his businesses. I really appreciate that about it. And that's one thing which I remember very, very clearly. The other thing I'd like to touch upon is the fact that, you know, his companies, especially in the earlier years and even now, the only reason I mentioned the earlier years is that the advertising they did was path-breaking, yet very human. And I think that is something he probably learned from his experiences with Alec and with Lintas. Because in the early 2000s, you know, people weren't doing that kind of slice of life, very real, very relatable kind of advertising, which Naukri and a couple of his other companies did. And I think they played a very huge role in what those companies are perceived as. And I would want Bichu to say something about that here.
Oh, okay. I'd love to be credit for the advertising, but it wasn't me. Right? But like I said,
no, I'm sure it wasn't you personally, but you know, you created an environment into which such ideas.
I think we got a team which, I'll tell you. So if you look at that Hari Sadhu commercial, right, it was preceded by two other commercials in similar vein. One of the washroom commercial, where Ravi Khote was in the washroom and he was yelling at a bunch of guys, and one guy splashed water on him, right? So I'll tell you what happened here. So we had only so much money, very little money. Usme media bhi karna hai aur creative bhi karna hai. And we said we didn't look at it like a traditional marketing company. This is your budget for the year. We said there is no deadline, right? But we are not going to spend media money behind a mediocre creative. So we hired an ad agency, FCB Ulka, and we kept rejecting whatever work they did.
A guy from Lintas would not be able to buy stuff from.
No, Lintas is a media agency, so we are giving business to Lintas as well. But I'll tell you, so we said, yeah, it has to be path breaking, because a great creative, can multiply your media money 10x, make it look like 10x. So we want a great creative, right? So it was quite frustrating for the agency. Guys, to, you know, 6 months away, which media mein ja nahi raha, everything being rejected. We said, we don't care. We only have 3.5 crores to spend on media. Right? You're getting a return, you bloody produce. Right? Now, one day, the creative director was sitting in the office, and a colleague of his was giving instruction to somebody over the phone, right? And he, you know, said to him, he was spending out a word, like we say, N for Nagpur, A for this, Agra, and so on. And from there, Hari Sadhu came.
And made history.
Right? And the insight was that, listen, everybody, there are three great relationships in life. One is a mother-son relationship, done to death in Hindi movies in the 70s and 80s. Right? The other is the Saas Bahu relationship, done to death in the TV serials in the early 2000s. Maybe early in the 90s. So there's a third great relationship in life that nobody's talked about. It's a boss-subordinate relationship. Right? And everybody in life has had a bad boss sometime.
Not your first one.
Everybody in life. So now you can't actually get back at your boss in real life. And, you know, even a boss has had a boss in the past. Might have been a bad boss, right? So junior to senior, something was coming in my life, a bad boss were. So can you make people live the fantasy of getting back at a bad boss in a humorous manner through this commercial? And that's what the insight was. And that's how the commercial came about. And it took us a lot of courage to actually make that film, because it was going to cost 30 lakhs. 30 lakhs in 2003-04 was huge money.
We just made
a profit.
Yeah.
It was going to eat up maybe 5% of our profit that year. Maybe whatever. Right? And just the cost of the creative production. Right? I chickened out. I said, yaar, ye bahut mehengi script hai. Right? And so did Hitesh. He said, yaar, bahut mehengi hai. Let's not spend this kind of money on the script. And we had a marketing manager called Aisha Kapoor, no longer with us now. She's become an entrepreneur. She's manufacturing ice cream. And we had an offsite, company offsite, where she came up with this. And he said, listen, I insist on this script. We've got to go with it. And that's how we went with it. So that's how that came out. But I want to talk a bit about all the three people you called here, Nandan.
Yes.
I think PDN was a perfect HR guy. He would always lend a sympathetic ear. You can go and talk about anything. He would always lend a sympathetic ear. He would not go and rat you out to your boss or your boss's boss. So you could confide in him. And he would find a tactful way of either suggesting to you or suggesting to your boss, ki boss is cool. Like what he said about letting me go. Right? And we came to a compromise solution. For 3 months, I was part-time in HMM.
Yes.
He said, listen, you don't have money, right? You don't have a full day either. You're starting a company. Why don't you work here half day? You'll pick up half the money. So you'll get some money. And he told Anup, boss, you find a replacement. He's here for 3 months. So PDN worked it out. It was totally unconventional for HMM to employ. I was the first part-time guy in HMM history.
Correct.
Okay. I'll tell you a couple of conversations with Bala. So
I don't think we should talk about you, Sanjeev. I don't want this. You can see my fear here.
No. So I'll tell you. So Bala had not invested in us. There were two groups in ICICI which were investing in startups. We had been invested in by the other group. Right? Post the meltdown in April 2000, ICICI merged these two groups. So Bala inherited us. And Bala inherited a portfolio of 32 dot-coms that were overvalued. Who want money gone with them? And very often, ICICI would invest in tranches. So should you give the next tranche or not? And that was a tough decision. Because if you don't give it, the company will die. But if you do give it, the company will die anyway, and you lose all your money. You lose even more money than you already put in. of the 32.com, I think Bala did not invest in 20, but then 28 of them. So you can at least not spend more money. Right? And it was a very, must be a very, very difficult thing to do. You know, because at the end of the day, it's a very hard choice to make.
Yeah, of course.
And then people get hassled. You know,
yeah.
They don't get the next money. Right? And also, which are the four to do it?
Absolutely.
And there, for some reason, Bala will be one of the four. Yeah. That was fortunate, I think, for us. It was fortunate for ICICI also, because they earned a good return finally. I think Bala had very good judgment on people, on companies, on opportunities. Also, I think Bala stood up once, and when in 2004 or 3, I think the investment committee of ICICI was getting tough with us, and they wanted to drag us along and sell us to somebody else at a very low price so they could get an exit. And Bala stood up and said, listen, if you touch this company, I will resign. And this is something I heard from somebody else, not from Bala. And that's when they did off. And the difference between a 10% return and 28.5x return, 28.5x return was that single decision of saying, I will resign if you touch this company.
Wow.
So they had all the clauses and the powers to do that in the agreement.
Very interesting.
But they chose to wait for 3 years.
Yeah.
And then the IPO happened and they got a great exit.
And actually, Sanjeev, I got a very attractive strategic offer, which he doesn't talk much about. But, any other entrepreneur, look at his decision making, right? Since this module is about Sanjeev. What did he say? He said, if I sell to this strat, okay, this is it for my employees, will lose their jobs, there'll be no, institution that will endure time and me, so again, that was why it was easy for me to say yes or no. I would have said it would have been a great exit for us even at the pricing that we're talking about. But just that intent of Sanjeev to create this institution was so palpable and real for me that it was very easy to say yes. Because again, as an investor, you have to be very hard-nosed and rational, right? But with Sanjeev, every time he makes it very easy to, for us to trust him and say, we're going to do this because he's going to get us to the goalpost eventually.
So, I have many great things to say about Dinesh and others in Linchess, what have I learned? But Dinesh, I'll give you one instant. So October 31st, Indira Gandhi died. We were told to go home early, right? I think there was a telex from the Madras office saying, is she dead? Did you know that something had happened? This is about 11 o'clock in the morning. So there were 3 landlines in the office. So there's only one had STD. So we went to the branch manager's room and called up Madras office. What is this? Said, don't you know she's been shot? That's when we found out. And then by about 3 o'clock, the branch manager, Dinesh's boss, Atul Sharma, he said, go home, guys. I don't know what's going to happen. Just go home. Now, it never occurred to me there'd be riots. So I rang up a friend who used to live very close to office in Greater Kailash 1 and said, listen, he was preparing for a CA exam. So he was at home, school friend. So, kya kar raha hai? Kuch nahi, main padh raha hu. Said, acha, mera office jaldi khatam ho gaya, I'll come. Okay, so I went to his house. By the evening, 6 o'clock, my mother called up and said, don't come home tonight. Come tomorrow morning, it may not be safe. So anyway, so I stayed the night there. Next morning, I tried to go home. There's no traffic on the roads and things. So I finally managed to somehow get an auto rickshaw to about 6 kilometers from my house. The last 6 kilometers I walked. And of those last 3 kilometers, I was walking through riots. So I saw and experienced those riots and I witnessed some people who were rioters and I noted down the car number.
Okay.
And they were offering people money to burn this house and so on and so forth. November fourth, fifth, I think, office opened again. And I remember we'd gone down for lunch in Nehru Place. There was Dinesh, there was you, me, Sanjeev Mehta, maybe one more guy, I forget. And I narrated this to you. And I said, I'm really scared to go to the authorities with the information that I have because I might be targeted. So Dinesh very gently suggested. And Dinesh is, by the way, half Sikh. Okay, he gently suggested. You know, it's up to you. Think about it. And I thought about it for 2 days. And finally, I went to the authorities. Nothing happened, but I went. Right? So this business of integrity, ethics, I think, apart from everything else, apart from, you know, Dinesh is the coolest guy in a crisis ever, right? Nothing fazed him, right? Dinesh would empower people, delegate. You know, so I had more sort of empowerment as a any under Dinesh than I had under anybody else for a long, long time. Right? But I think more than that, it was this one incident that stands out for me.
Yeah.
That without preaching to me about my duties, or without concurring with me that, listen, yeah, you're right, you should not go to the police. Because of, I don't know if you remember this incident, but a gentle nudge without seeming like a nudge, I think, That instance stands out.
Yeah, thank you, Sanjeev. Amazing story, amazing.
And Sanjeev, there are a couple of audience questions, and I want to ask one audience question before I ask one question from my own. Dr. Harivansh Chaturvedi from BIMTEC is asking, Sanjeev, you created a paradigm shift in the recruitment market in the last few decades. What do you foresee happening post-COVID?
See, what are the things? It depends on the timing, nature, and manner of freedom from COVID as and when it happens. Right? Now, is it going to go away? By when is it going to go away? And what will it be the manner of it going away? Right? So, if it goes away in 6 months and things are back to normal, there'll be no change. If it lingers for the next 5 years with no cure, but this low intensity, right? It'll sputter a lot, right? And this work from home thing may become a little bit more permanent. Now, what has happened because of COVID is, I think, you know, the freshers job market has been hit the worst. Companies are not expanding headcount in a hurry, right? And that will be a challenge.
Yep.
But two freshers, two people who are students, I would say, look, right now, just treat it as a gap year. If you don't get a placement, it's okay, it's life, that's how it is. But yep. Can you get an internship even if it's unpaid? Can you add value to your CV? Can you acquire a narrow vertical skill?
Yeah.
As a market. And that narrow vertical skill could be digital marketing, could be, you know, search engine optimization, could be anything.
Could be editing videos.
But it should be a narrow vertical skill that or talent that has a market, right? While at the same time trying to get some work experience in an organization, even if it means working home, even without salary. After 1 year, can you claim that work experience in your CV? After 1 year, can that organization absorb you because now they're expanding again?
Thank you so much, Sanjeev. My own question, you know, you achieved everything. You're a successful entrepreneur, Bala, PDN, Mr. Khanna, everyone is praising you, and you know, it's very authentic. You got a Padma Award, you built a $1 billion enterprise, you mentored other successful startups. What else is left to do? I know you said you want to build institutions, you're part of building Ashoka. So, is there a bucket list that Sanjeev Bikhchandani has?
No, the point is you keep working, right? Every day. So, none of this was planned. None of this was targeted. It was, bhai, roz kaam karna
hai. Wo main samajhta hu. Main samajhta hu. But ab to aap plan karte hai na.
I don't plan my own career. I never did.
There's no bucket list.
So I never planned my career after becoming an entrepreneur. Since 1990, I've not planned my career. I took life as it came.
So there is no bucket list, Sanjeev has.
No, there's no bucket list.
Koi aise restaurant bhi nahi hai jahan jaake khana khana hai.
अब तो कोविड में रेस्टोरेंट जाना बंद हो गया है, मैं तो सोचना बंद कर दिया, रेस्टोरेंट बंद हो गया.
But now you can connect the dots, Sanjeev. Sanj,
you can
connect the dots.
No, you can, but it's always in hindsight, right? You never connect them looking ahead.
Yeah.
So all this is, you know, all that happened in the past, and now is how you were smart, yeah. Not smart, you got lucky also.
Thank you, Sanjeev. All the best.
Thank you.
And if there are three predictions you were to make for the future of work, future of workplaces, you know, we've lost 30 million jobs in India.
Look, people don't change so easily. Human beings are social. Ultimately, you want to go to office, you want to be with people, you want to have that coffee across the table with a guy, you want to have lunch with your colleagues. It's just the risk of COVID. The moment that goes away, you know, the human DNA does not change. Man is a social animal.
Yeah.
And now that Trump is gone, maybe COVID will follow.
I don't think so, but there's no correlation there.
I hope so.
Well,
but yeah, the liberal order may come back. But he's not gone yet.
I hope.
Till the final results are out. Do we have time for another question, which is a few questions that have come up?
Yeah, so we'll take one more question. There's a question from Subir. Subir says, I've known Sanjeev since 90s.
Subir's
when I first met him, Arvind and Hitesh. My question is, what steps is he and his enterprise taking to minimize competition with LinkedIn? And Naukri is clearly a product of
Subir. I remember Subir. So, you know, I had gone to Ahmedabad to take a couple of classes in Ahmedabad. So, when the riots were happening in Ahmedabad, there was a 1 week lull in the riots. So riots bandh hue, so people thought riots are over, so classes started. So I went, and then riots started again. Right, so since I was in Ahmedabad, you know, in between classes, I would make some sales calls. So I had met Subir that time, and we did discuss what was going on in the city. I remember that clearly. And Subir has now moved to Delhi. Yeah, so Subir, we are trying to do stuff. I think first of all, we're deepening our current product offerings in Naukri to make sure that we can defend that. Then we've got an initiative in senior jobs, passive jobs. There's something called job hai for blue collar jobs. There's something called big shift for, you know, passive jobs, senior levels. There's still experiments, but let's see what happens there.
Thank you so much, Sanjeev.
But Naukri in its current form will not offer what LinkedIn offers.
Okay.
Very interesting. And before we close, anybody wants to talk about any episode, any anecdote that you remember? Dinesh, during your years at Lintas, you know, I mean, how agency life is all a lot of fun and as well as a lot of things that happen. Anything that you remember, you know, and I'll call him Sanj, like I always did.
No, actually, you know, in the early 80s, advertising agency is more a club than a profession. And I probably embodied, you know, all those things. And Sanjeev gives me too much credit in terms of being, you know, someone who was good at delegating. My point is that he was someone who was great at just taking on responsibility. And that was, as far as I was concerned, tu kar le ya, theek hai. Kharab nat kariyo, you know. and really, I mean, I think that's a very important point he made, that, you know, it's not just a question of, you know, be careful.
So Dinesh's thing was, but just don't get me screwed, huh?
I just want to add one thing, if I can just very quickly. You see, one of the things which I noticed, because Sanjeev left HMM in the 92s and more than 30 years nearly, but I met him many times in many areas. One thing I just want to tell him, since we were talking about the humility which he has demonstrated then and today, I've never seen it changed. I think, you know, he has become a great entrepreneur, very successful leader. He set the trendsetter for many others to follow him from the same institute or other places. He has become the role model. But, you know, when I was the DMA president in early 2000 or NHRD president, he was always very actively supporting despite his heavy schedules. And at that time, he was still growing and he has to invest on his time and business. But he was doing this. And I can't recall when I rang him up in US once, I need some support for NHRD network, immediately said it's done. And when he received the Padma Award, late in the night, I took the liberties to call him. Immediately called me to thank, which shows that even after nearly 30 years, for me, what he was a management trainee, today what he is a great entrepreneur or institution builder. I didn't say it. I think this is something which is a truly a great role model for many others.
So I have to have
DNA
to say
doesn't
something.
Change, right? The DNA doesn't change.
Change, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So I do need to say something else.
Yeah, of course.
So I think, you know, we just went through as a company and as part of the board, a QIP in which the company raised $250 million during the lockdown. Okay, I think what is the one thing that Sanjeev made sure when he was building this institution is the highest level of corporate governance that with which he and Hitesh and everybody else run this organization. It is you know, so much an integral part of who Sanjeev is, and that gets reflected as onto Poet as an institution. You know, that $250 million QIP, despite all the lockdown, was oversubscribed 5 times. So, you know, that is what I would think is Sanjeev is, as a person, has made sure that he will not do anything wrong. He will be successful on his terms of integrity, which is so rare and so refreshing. Absolutely. It's really, really welcome.
Last word from Dinesh.
Oh, first word and last word. One thing which no one else seems to be saying, but he is an extremely argumentative person. And we happen to be on one WhatsApp group with the 6 of us who used to be in Linters together, you know, 36 years ago, whatever. And whether it's politics, whether it's cricket, whether it's films, you know, Sanjeev and I have had lots of arguments. including fallouts, but he's as quick to apologize as I, if I may say so, as I am, and which is what I think values are about. And I agree with him in terms of, you know, that's depends on where you come from, you know, and the families we came from and the families we hopefully are and will therefore influence, you know, our kids and their kids thereafter. Is that's all it is about, you know. There really is, as far as I'm concerned, nothing else. It's about being human, it's about being humane.
Dinesh, you need me on your side. Sanjeev doesn't argue with me. He doesn't dare.
I know where the money's coming from.
A good one.
And he knows that I have none.
That's so, Sanjeev has the last word. I must thank you all, and I think Anu had to leave. He had 1 o'clock, he had a board meeting or something, and I want to thank you all for being there. Thank you, Sanj. It's been fascinating. Thank you so promptly to agree to be there, and wonderful to have you and, you know, chat with you after, and we've done that in between, but with so many friends together, it's amazing. Thank you, Bala. Thank you, Dwanka. Thank you.
Thank you.